Ladies and gentlemen, I hope that lunch was really delicious and you had lots of great and insightful conversations. So for the last session for today, will be Maqasid Syariah and the well-being of Malaysians. The first speaker will be Dr. Masli Malik, who will speak on Maqasid Syariah and whether could it be a vision of well-being for Muslims. He will be followed by Dr. Iqbal Abdul Wahab, who will then try to answer the question on whether could Maqasid Syariah advance justice. Our third speaker will be Mr. Abdul Nasir, who will discuss on whether would Maqasid Syariah curb freedom. Finally, we have Dr. Zulkifli Ahmad, who will then engage everyone as a discussant to today's forum. This session will be moderated by Dr. Wong Chin Huat. Dr. Wong is the head of political and social analysis and fellow at Penang Institute. He read comparative democratization at the University of Essex in the United Kingdom, and his research interests cover electoral system, party system, federalism, parliamentary democracy, communal politics, multiculturalism, and differentiated citizenship. He writes political commentaries in Malay, English, and Chinese for the media at home and abroad. To answer the 1946 question of Malaysia's nation building, can citizens be different yet equal? He has developed a keen interest in the politics of Sharia in recent years. A founding member, Dr. Wong has been active in the electoral reform movement, Coalition for Clean and Fair Elections, also known as BERSE, since 2006. Let's welcome our moderator and speakers onto stage. And as per usual, the speakers will take on questions in the Q&A session, so please have your questions ready. Thank you.
May I invite our speakers and panelists and discussant to the stage? Yang Berhormat, YB Malik. Tan Sri Sharif, Dr. Sharon, and colleagues from G25, PI, and ladies and gentlemen, thanks for coming back to our third part, third leg of the dialogue. Dr. Sri? Okay, so now if we recall just now that Yang Ahmad Berhormat, CM, talk about we need dialogue after democracy, diversity and democracy. And if you look back at the design, in the first panel, the discussion was really about the problems that have emerged. And the second panel, we move on to look at the context of all these changes, what happened in these few years. And now we try to look for solution. So this is the most challenging one. And I believe that for most of us, the discussion of Maqasid Syariah is rather new. This is a panel, except Dr. Zhu. The panel is all from UIA. Yeah. The last panel, the second panel was all from Singapore. The first panel was all from all lawyers, right? So you see that this homogeneity. But otherwise, you would say that all of them are Muslims. Now you probably wonder why is Wong Chin not here? I wrote a piece on Maqasid Syariah as the potential game changer and in Malaysia Kini, and a reader actually asked and said, "Is Wong Chin a Chinese Muslim?" So I need to clarify that I'm not a Chinese Muslim. So what business does a kafir have here trying to moderate, like, you know, four accomplished scholars or experts on Maqasid Syariah? But this is exactly where I think that's interesting. If we talk about Sharia law moving into private sphere, it's not uncommon to have non-Muslim involved because, like, for example, lawyers, many of them are non-Muslim. But when you come to this, there are people who ask and say, no, this is supposed to be a pure Muslim affair. Why should it be? The answer is exactly this. Is Maqasid Syariah a matter of theology or a matter of governance? If it's a matter of theology, then, you know, except for the experts and the Muslim, the kafir has no business here. But if this is going to be a business of governance, a public policy, then everyone is a stakeholder. And that's why you have this kafir moderating the session. Okay, so first speaker is Dr. Masli Malik. He's very well known to many people, assistant professor at international at the International Islamic University of Malaysia. He taught on fiqh, usul al-fiqh, political Islam, modern Islam, political issues and political theory since 2000. He was a guest speaker at the SUES Summer School on Political Islam and has considerable experience as an Islamic humanitarian activist and journalist in both Southeast Asia and the Middle East, including extensive NGO charity work in Lebanon and Jordan. His main area of research includes Islamic jurisprudence, contemporary Islamic political thoughts and movements, and good governance. And he is also a senior fellow at the Institute for Democratic and Economic Affairs, otherwise IDEAS, libertarian think tank. Now, the topic he's going to speak exactly is this. He argues that Maqasid Syariah is the idea of well-being. But is that well-being one exclusive to the Muslim? Dr. Masli?
Assalamu alaikum and very good afternoon to everybody. Thank you very much, Dr. Ching Huat. You know, it's very interesting when Dr. Ching Huat trying to say that he's the only kafir here on the stage trying to deal with Islamic issues. It just remind me of a lot of other kafirs or kufar, in Arabic the plural for kafirs kufar, who are dealing with Islamic issues and they're being fair, even much fairer than Muslims themselves. People like J.L. Esposito, for example, people like Edward Said, yeah, precisely, and my previous supervisor Rodney Wilson, who is a big name in Islamic banking and finance, and others. But it triggers, I mean, being a libertarian, give me a liberty to look into another name, another big name, who people might never thought that this guy is a kafir who really understand Islam and trying to translate some of the Islamic values into what we know nowadays as the liberalism thought, which is Edward Pocock, the very professor and the very top guru of John Locke, yeah, who was teaching at Oxford, who was an expert on Hay bin Yaqadhan, one of the Andalusian scholars who deal with philosophical issues, and I think the very idea of tabula rasa derived from the Hay bin Yaqadhan's book. Ibn Tufayl's book, Hay bin Yaqadhan. Hay bin Yaqadhan is the story of which is akin to, it's not Tarzan, Jungle Book. Not Robinson Crusoe. Robinson Crusoe is very colonial in nature. Yeah. Anybody who likes Robinson Crusoe, there's something wrong with him. British love Robinson Crusoe very much. Let me say, Rudyard Kipling, Jungle Book. Yeah. So about a boy who grew up in isolated island and taught himself as a deer instead of a human being. So that's Hay bin Yaqadhan, a fictitious story about that that boy that been written by Ibn Tufayl. And Ibn Tufayl, idea of tabula rasa has been translated by Edward Pocock and later being introduced by his most loyal disciple, John Locke, the father of liberalism. Very unfortunate. And, you know, another, there are a lot of kafir, kufar, or dealing with Islamic issues in Muslim history and have been contributed enormously into Islamic scholarship. But this is not the forum to talk about all those kafirs, especially during Andalusian period. What I'm going to talk here is about Maqasid Syariah being a well-being instead of being a set of rules or set of law. Actually, it's not only Maqasid Syariah, Dr. Ching Huat. Even the word Syariah has been misunderstood. And since morning, people are talking about Syariah, but unfortunately, Syariah in a very limited scope of legalistic matter, positive legalistic understanding. And it's very unfortunate the way some of those so-called anti-Syariah or Syariah critics looking at Syariah is the same way those extremists and radicals looking into Syariah. For them, Syariah is only a set of rules. It's all about chopping. You become Muslim, you need to chop something, some part of your body, And if you do wrong, you need to be chopped. I mean, some of your limbs need to be chopped. You leave Islam, your head need to be chopped. And there come the critics saying that, oh, this is not Islam, Sharia is this and that. But they are dealing in a very, you know, specific small elements of Sharia. Instead, I mean, enormous and, you know, all-encompassing idea of Sharia as a way of life and a philosophy. Okay, just now I was asking Ching Huat, they said that Dr. Ching Huat, where is Pei Zhong, our MC, because I want to make some claim of my travel expenses. And, you know, we lecturers in Malaysia, we have been underpaid. I mean, I have to be honest. If you invite us, make sure, I mean, if we need to sacrifice our weekends, make sure it's worth it. No, unlike maybe our academics from Singapore, Nawa, Prof. Alatas, I think the same problem. Singapore? Oh, that's an insult to PAP government then. Oh, okay, sorry. Okay. So we were talking about, we need to make some claim. I mean, taxi, I have to park my car, you know, tolls, toll hike, and, you know, those kind of things. It's really burdensome. Anyway, so he said, oh, but make sure you have all the receipts. Okay, all the receipts. That's the problem. I just threw them away. Okay. Said, why? Because it's kind of practice for, I mean, a good covenant practice, a good practice of, you know, during the auditing, we need all those evidence. Without those evidence, we are going to give bad name for Penang government, state government. No, that's my word. Okay. So, and I told him, actually, that is very Maqasid Syariah. Being transparent, being trustworthy, being true to yourself, that is Maqasid Syariah. And as you remember, a few years ago, it was in Penang, one of the Member of Parliament of Penang, without naming any specific name, he said that he has a problem with one of his Ahli Majlis. And he said that this guy belonged to a radical extremist movement named Pertubuhan Jamaah Islam Malaysia. So it has been picked up by the media. You know, media like to sensationalize everything apart from truth. So I'm just joking. So when he was asked why, because he said Pertubuhan Jamaah Islam Malaysia, also known as JIM, is aiming towards the implementation of Sharia by the year 2020. So everybody said, wow, that sounds spooky. I mean, that sounds dangerous. Sharia in Malaysia by 2020? Okay. And then came the Chief Minister Lim Guan Eng into the picture and said, no, I know these people. I've been with them since when I was a normal politician. I know their presidents at Kamarudin. They are not extremists, they're not radicals. But the main issue was not addressed. The word Sharia there. So the problem is with the understanding of the word Sharia. The same thing happened in the UK when the former Archbishop of Canterbury, Dr. William Atkinson, not Rowan Atkinson, they're two both different people. William Atkinson, in the year 2008, he said that he appeared in media and said that Sharia law is inevitable in the UK. You know, for that very month, it was the Archbishop of Canterbury bashing month. The media, everybody from upside down, everywhere, saying that this guy is crazy, out of his mind. I mean, you know, all those Pakasa of UK and all those red shirt of UK by the name EDL or, you know, whatever they call themselves. Because they fear the word Sharia. And the word Sharia is not only feared by them, but also by Muslims. With different motivations. Why? Because they don't really look into the bigger picture of Sharia. So, coming back to the receipts, I said that this is what we call Sharia, Maqasid Sharia. There's abundance of prophetic traditions and practices of the caliphs who succeeded Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who emphasized a lot on good governance. Datuk Malik said that they are going to have a series of forums Rahmatun Lil Alamin, they're going to deal with all these issues, good governance and Islam and whatever, and even during the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I still remember in a book written by Ibn Taymiyyah, Al-Hisbah. I know Ibn Taymiyyah, not many people here in Malaysia like him, and his name has been misquoted or misassociated with the Salafi movement. That's very unfortunate. Only if we manage to see him through the lens of Fazlur Rahman, the well-known reformist of Pakistan, we would appreciate him a lot. In that book, when he was addressing about the issue of public administration and governance and policies, he said that all these things is part of religious responsibilities. He said it's not about worldly affairs, but said these are religious responsibilities where all the office barriers, where all the politicians, where all the leaders will be held accountable before God during the time of resurrection. So we can find a lot in many prophetic tradition. Just now when Lim Guan Eng was talking about being transparent, and they have no problem of exposing nakedly about the funding that they receive, whether the party or the state government, and they said that every single adun has nothing to hide. You can look at their wealth. This is what been practiced by Prophet Muhammad. There's a hadith narrated in Sahih Bukhari, which is considered a sound hadith according to Sunni tradition. He said that there was a tax collector named Ibn Lutaybiyah who came back to Medina and sent a huge amount of tax that had been collected. Zakat, they call it. Huge amount of zakat been collected by the people of one of the places which is outside Medina. And when he sent back all those huge amount, he still have few amounts of wealth with him. And Prophet Muhammad said, what about those? He said, no. Those are not from zakat. Those are donations given to me. But it did not exceed $700. And $700 million. No. I don't really know the amount because it was not stated in that prophetic tradition. But she said, so what about those? She said, no. Those are donations given to me and nothing to do with zakat. So the Prophet asked him, should you stay inside your parents' house and you're not the tax collector, will you be given that amount of money? Will you be given that amount of wealth? He said no. Then send it back or give it to the public. So what does it indicate? It indicates transparency, accountability. And he said after that to the Muslims, when we appointed officers to the office, we are giving them salary. We are giving them what they need in their life. Whatever they take beyond that is considered corruption. This is good governance, and that is Maqasid Syariah. It's very unfortunate. The other day, Wong Ching Hout was with us in one of the forums organized by Pertubuhan Ikram Malaysia, which metamorphosized, okay, thank you, okay, which is the next version of Pertubuhan Jamaah Islam Malaysia, who was accused of being extremist. So we were talking about, when we talk about Maqasid Syariah, it's all about well-being. It's not only about chopping, it's not only about, we have to look, beyond that, and beyond power, and beyond positive legalistic framework, beyond legal issues. When we talk about the other day, a lot of my friends, they got involved with these Go Green campaigns, including my children. They love that so much. So I told them, this is very Shariatic. You're doing jihad, actually, to save the world. You're doing jihad for the next generation. I said, wow, but the word jihad is, it's very taboo. I said, must you surrender to those people who abuse the word jihad? Must you abuse to those people who abuse the word Sharia? No. We have to bring back the word jihad. We have to bring back the word Sharia. We have to bring back the word Maqasid to its proper meaning, to its original meaning, which is to preserve the well-being of human society. It goes beyond religion. It goes beyond faith. It goes beyond, you know, all this legal framework. Okay, some might say, oh, it sounds very rhetoric, lah, very cliche again. But this is a problem that we're facing nowadays. When we try to confine Sharia in a very narrow interpretation or whatever, people will start playing the word Sharia. I'm more Sharia than that person. We are calling for Sharia. So what Sharia we are lacking of? Yes, we are lacking of Sharia because we don't have a transparent government. We have corrupted politicians ruling over us. And we are destroying the environment. And we, you know, we compromise with a lot of things that will that's detrimental for the next generation. And you don't call that Sharia? So, as I remember, I always tell my students that when you're learning about Sharia, looking at Sharia, you know, all these efforts for good governance, all those efforts for healthy well-being, all those efforts to bring good policies for the well-being of the people, that is Sharia. If you want to talk about all these legal issues or whatever, yes, I would say that is part of Sharia. But one thing, you're talking about Maqasid Syariah, amongst the discussion about Maqasid Syariah is to look at the consequences or the implication of whatever ruling or whatever rigor ruling you want to implement. A lot of examples that have been shown by Prophet Muhammad that he put moratorium on certain things and he did not execute certain rules or punishment because he fear of the consequences or the ramification of the rules. So there is an idea of moratorium of certain things due to the context and situation. I don't think this is the place to talk about that. I hope that G25 and Penang Institute would consider to organize another round of talk on Maqasid Syariah, specifically on Maqasid Syariah, on December, where we will deal in a wider scope of Maqasid Syariah itself. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Masli. And in case you find that you think that Maqasid is actually a strange word to us, it's actually the plural form of Maqsud, meaning. So it's just like Kufar to Kafir, this is Maqasid to Maqsud. So next we'll invite Dr. Muhammad Iqbal. Dr. Iqbal looks more like a musician, and that's really because he is a musician. But his day job is actually a lecturer at IIU's Department of Civil Laws at the Ahmad Ibrahim Kulliyah of Laws. And he also serves as Deputy Dean for Student Affairs. His specialization is criminal law, civil law, and defenses in criminal laws. So, Dr. Iqbal.
Come on. No. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you very much, Dr. Wong. And Tan Sri, Dato' Dato', professors, colleagues, brothers and sisters. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Oh, the mic. I thought my voice is strong enough. Normally in class, I very seldom use mic, but you have to use this. Okay, I think Dr. Masli has already stolen the show, and that makes me become very angry and stressful. And he spoke about Hay ibn Yakzan of Ibn Tufail. Oh, this is very interesting. But I think Hay ibn, correct me please, Hay ibn Yakzan is actually, it's not a real story. It's not a true story. It's just he created this story. It's out of his own imaginations and fantasies. He created this. And then from that, it becomes so influential that in the end, it gives a very strong impact in the Western civilization, actually. So you spoke about people like John Locke, and even the declarations of American independence was very much influenced by the concept of happiness from Hay ibn Yakzan. So this is not a real story, but it's very interesting. How people, when he has already reached very high levels of intellectuality, then perhaps even his imagination could actually become something very significant in the contributions of human civilizations and knowledge. But I'm not talking about Hay ibn Yakzan. The topic given to me is something like, can Maqasid Syariah
advance justice?
Advance justice. So this is a very straightforward question. You cannot get anything more straight than that. And then, only this is a very straightforward answer. My answer is a very big yes. And only if we only if we can sit down and really understand what is actually the meaning of Maqasid and its relationship with Sharia, of course. And actually, it involves very significantly discussions about the roles of revelations and also reasons, which has been a very interesting topic for discussions. And and why I say that, you know, before I go to that question, before I come back to that question again, you know, while doing some, I'm a very lousy musician and at the same time a very lazy academic person, and I only make my preparations in the very last minute. So I was told that it was, and I'm very thankful for the organization for giving me this opportunity, inviting me, and you know, and having the opportunity to talk in front of very hardworking people. Very onerous and with a very strong ambitions for peace, tranquility, good governance. I'm very honored to be given this opportunity. So, and I'm doing some reading in the very last minute. It's very interesting for me to find out that actually this is a case of what is known to be an abandoned ship case. This is Al-Ghazali, Imam Al-Ghazali, passed away 1111. Very interestingly also, coincidentally, my room number is also 1111. And this 1111, actually, my room number. And Al-Ghazali has given this, he was the one who started off the discussions of this abandoned ship. What is the case of abandoned ship? Abandoned ship is a situation where there is a shipwreck, and then in saving the life of the majority of the people in the ship, there is a need for a captain to make a very difficult decision, that is to throw some of the people in the ship into the sea. So you have to throw 10 people in order to save the life of the rest. So the question is, can that be done? And what would be the justification? What would be the explanation from the context of Sharia? And things like that. That was a case of abandoned ship that was promoted by Al-Ghazali in one of his writings. I did not read the original copy of that particular hypothetical case by Imam Ghazali himself. It is from the explanations by another writers in his commentary to that particular case of Imam Ghazali. So what happened is that I remember straight away, while teaching criminal law, you have the case of U.S. against Holmes. This is an American case. This is in the 19th or maybe 18th centuries case, where the situation exactly the same. You have a shipwreck, and then the captain has got to make this decision. And what happened? The captain of the ship really throw some 5 people from the ship. After throwing everything else, and then there is a very great danger to the life of the members of the ship. And then he decided, he have got to make this difficult decision by having to throw others. And then he decided, he asked his crew members to pick up a man and separate men from women and throw all the men from the ship. So I can see the relation. I've never found this. I've never discovered the interesting connection between Imam Al-Ghazali's writing and this case. And suddenly when doing in a very lazy way, I feel like, oh, there is a connection. Whether this, I'm sure this is a mere coincidence, but very interesting. And then, so the issue is, how are you going to make this? Can you make that decision? What is, through what channel? How do you actually explain? And also, at the end of the day, justice. Is that, by doing that, saving the life of others, of course, that is the intention. Are you doing justice at the same time? Justice in a very big scope of the word. And there's an English case pula, ya Allah, R against Dudley Stephen. This is a landmark case as far as the defense of necessity is concerned. Any law schools will have this case being investigated and also researched. What happened in R against Dudley Stephen is more or less the same. This is a situation, but it is not more or less the same. It's even more outrageous than this, because the member crew of a shipwreck has got to eat the flesh of one of the members in order for not only to eat, to kill first, and then after that, to live upon the dead body of that person. There was five. They were five. One seems to be the weakest of all. After sometimes where there is no opportunity, nothing whatsoever, to be rescued, and then they came up with this idea of why not we kill that guy? He can, after all, he is dying. And then at the end of the day, the rest agreed, and they really kill and leave. They managed to live for a few more days and then rescued. And then matter was brought to court, and the court decided, what have you done? I have done this. The issue is, can you do that? Justice. Of course you live. It was a very good decision, I would say, isn't it? If not because of that, perhaps all of them would have been killed. All of them would have died. But it's just because of that brilliant idea of one of the crew members that in the end of this saved the life of four, but at the expense of the life of that one particular person. And then, there's another interesting discovery. Not to say discovery, connections and interrelations. You have the defense of necessity and the Malaysian Penal Code, Section 81, which more or less of the same character. It's about saving the life of 10, risking the life of one or two, while at the same time trying to save the life of another 100 persons, for example. You see the illustrations of Section 81 of in the Malaysian Penal Code in relation to the defense of the necessity. So what I'm trying to say here is that the answer, if you go and then after all this, you go back to the abandoned ships of Imam Ghazali and see what he has in mind. What was his solution with regards to that matter? And then I go back one by one. Decisions of the American courts in the case of U.S. Holmes, the decisions of the English, the House of Lords, the decisions in the case of Dudley Stephen, and then you have this Malaysian funeral. At the end of the day, to cut it short, the timekeeper is not there yet. And the answer is all no. Cannot. The argument is very strong and very, very compelling. You know, this is about saving the life of others. I think that is the best because, well, rather than everybody dies, at least you save the life of many at the expense of, that is considered to be sacrifice. I mean, that is perhaps so you may want to argue from that line. But and you go to Imam, but when you go to then Imam Ghazali at the end of the decided actually no, because the value of life is not for human being to decide. Tak ada jalan sebenarnya. And jahatnya Islamic law. No, U.S. Holmes won at the end of the day in decisions is just like that. Yes, we can understand. This is a very compelling situation. The circumstances is such that you're having to make decisions, very difficult situations at a time when your degree of rationality is very low because you do not know whether you are able to live tomorrow. You know, that is the difficulties. But at the end of the day, when it comes 5 minutes, oh my God. When it comes to decision, the court says, no, you cannot. And Dudley Stephen, suddenly British courts become very religious, referring to Bible, referring to this and that. And then suddenly when it comes to decision also, but if you read the case, for once you thought that the judges, the House of Lords, the law lords are actually very sympathetic to the plight of this 3-4 men. But at this, this is difficult situation. We are not there. We talk about it at a time when we are normal. We do not know what they have suffered and things like that. But it comes to, this is still a murder. And then necessity pun, despite the fact that yang benda ni nampak, despite the fact that you have this, but when there's a real test case, the court is not prepared to go to that extremes by justifying to take away the life of others for the sake of saving the life of others also, for that matter. At the end of the day, what the point which I'm trying to make is that you see that on the one hand, you have all this. You talk about being progressive. You talk about being open. You talk about being liberal, but at the same time, when it comes to matters of reality, you see that many of the contributors of human civilizations and also knowledge have, at the end of the day, agreed that there must be limitations towards this. They must be the job for our job now is the challenge. The challenge is to find out what are the red lines, what are the limitations. Of course, we want to be open, we want to be liberal, we want to be as much as possible practical and sensible. The other day I spoke to one professors from Aceh, Syiah Kuala, bukan Syiah Kuala. Dia ada orang tak hantar anak. Pasal dia kata, ni universiti Syiah. Pasal this is not Syiah. This is Syiah Kuala. Belajarlah sikit. And come on. And so this professor said, okay, now the problem, we all agree that Islam, okay, let's say that we all agree that Islam solved problems. Well, the next challenge is that in doing so, how, what would be the mechanism? What would be, how do you explain to people that Islam is the best? Or you refer to all traditional examples that we often heard about. Just now, Dr. Mazli was quoting one of the, and then you have the Omar Abdul Aziz, Omar Al-Khattab, and all these things. You heard so many. But that was the past. That was the past. Brilliant, fantastic. Some people cry, man. But what about reality? What about now, man? Islam alone, apa justice dia? So the challenge is for us to prove that actually we are just like that also. But what will be the mechanism? So according to this professor, then of course there's none other but from the tools of ijtihad. Tapi sekarang ijtihad. Nanti orang kata, closing gate of ijtihad lah, the qualification of mujtahid. Melekat, tak jalan juga. So at the end of the day, okay, if that is, so, then the next question is, okay, now let us agree that we want to have, then maqasid comes lah. Then Maqasid Syariah comes. The whole idea is about this, you know, protecting the religion, protecting life, protecting the offsprings and also procreation, protecting the intellect and also the property. These are the five Maqasid, the objectives of Syariah, to protect all these five, developed by Ghazali and later expanded by others. He said that, okay, if that is the case, how are we? Okay, are we prepared? Like, please. Are we prepared to leave the old traditional approach towards our religion in order for us to solve our modern, contemporary democratic state's problem? That is the million-dollar questions. We have all these textual authorities, but now we have a completely different set of living, isn't it? We have completely different set of life and lifestyles and the inventions of technologies and things like that. People become more and more complicated. How are we to do? Are we prepared to leave this in order for us to achieve something? And at the end of the last question, so okay, this is my last point. The final question is, what would be the red line test? Now we agree that we have to give a fresh interpretations. We have to revisit and we have to go and try to make fresh investigations as to the need, all these things, how to solve a human problem. But what would be the red line? So as not to be accused of being a pure liberal or someone who leave religions completely and altogether and at... So how are you develop a system where we want to achieve something, but at the same time not to be accused of being a pure liberals? Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum.
Thank you, Dr. Iqbal. He claims that he didn't do preparation. I think he did. Now, next we'll get Mr. Abdul Nasir Tun Abdul Rahman, also known as Sifu Nasir. Now, he is also a musician, but he looks more like a magician with his hair, right? His specialization is actually inter-religious dialogues, comparative religions, religious philosophy. He's also active in the Malaysian Chinese Muslim Association in Selangor, because he's actually half a Chinese. Now, we have touched on the questions whether Maqasid Syariah can advance justice. Sifu's topic is, will Maqasid Syariah curb freedom? And I think this question is particularly interesting, and for him, because when we talk about Sharia rules, one big question is that people sometimes forget that we are now living in Malaysia, not Tanah Melayu. Right? But there's always people forget about Sabah and Sarawak. And in Sabah and Sarawak, sometimes that people feel yearning the most for freedom. Sifu is a Melana from Sarawak. Sifu.
Alright, after Dr. Masli Malik and Dr. Iqbal, I think saya hanya kata terima kasih sahaja. What is left for me to say? And I try to renew my birth certificate this year, and there's one begawai, and I ask me what is your bangsa. You can choose either Chinese or Melanau. Yeah, and because my mother is a Chinese, my father is a Melanau. You can choose either or. Okay, fine. Okay, so I say that if I choose my father, race, my mom kesiana. If I choose my mom race, my father kesiana. Which one? So I suggested to her, can I invent a new race, Cilanau? She was looking at me, Muslima, you know. Seems a very good Muslima with the very long tutung, you know. And then, okay. How about Bangsa Malaysia? And I say, okay lah, kan masuk Islam, masuk Melayu. So, Melayu can lah? Oh, can lah. You're not a Malay. Fine. So, it's not that I don't want to be a Malay. You are the people who do not want me to become Malay. Okay. And then finally, I'm more into Chinese. My mom is a Chinese. I ask her, which one has special rights? Of course, Melanau, Bumi Putra. So I'm now a Bumi Putra. Because whenever I argue or involved in an argument, a heated argument, usually people will sort of at the end of the argument, lu balik Cina lah. Difficult. And okay. Next, please. All right. Now, I am a philosopher actually, and my aim and my one of my icon is Al Ghazali. Unfortunately, they have all stolen my philosophy. I have nothing to talk about Al Ghazali. Al Ghazali, in his book Tahaf Al Falasifah, my aim is not to defend anything here, but to destroy. So today, I'm here to destroy, not to defend anything. For instance, the word inclusive, and is to exclude to those who we do not include. Sometimes when we use the word inclusive and exclusive, to label others as conservative, as Salafi, as Wahhabi, I think is again a sleight of hand here, because what do you mean by inclusive? In order to be inclusive, you have to be exclusive to some extent. So I would say that sometimes when we deal with the masses, when we talk about Islam, we do not think that people are what they call not our level of thinking. We must try to understand that they are detecting our discourse. And I'm labeled as sometimes for the Wahhabi, I'm labeled as liberal. For the liberal, I'm labeled as Wahhabi. But for my wives, they label me as naughty husband. Next. Okay, my mom, Chinese. My dad is a Melanau. Melayu Melanau. He's actually Tun Abdul Rahman Yaakob and passed away recently. And he, alhamdulillah, I was brought up as a non-Muslim, my mother. And my father and mother divorced when I was a baby. I was brought up as a non-Muslim until the age of 20. And I did ask my father, very good father actually, but because of 13 Mei and divorce, something like that, my father trusted my mother to take care of me. And I was brought up by my mother. I was living in a house. In a house, I have a dog. His name was Lucky. I have a dog, a nice dog. I didn't have brother and sisters. He is my dog was my only brother and sister. And which I grew up in a non-Muslim Chinese family. And I learned a lot. And I did ask my father, why did you sort of allow me to grow up in a non-Muslim environment, a kafir environment. And then I brought up as a kafir. And I used to worship my ancestors and the Latuk Kong, you know, Chinese here, you understand. But my father gave me a very good advice. In the end, you came back to Islam by choice, not by heritage, not by chance. And this is Maqasid Syariah, actually. Maqasid Syariah trains us. What do you mean by freedom? When we talk about freedom, we always talk about Islamization by force, where we impose Islamization. We do not give even the born Muslim a chance to choose Islam by choice. And I appreciate Al-Ghazali precisely because he actually, in his book Al-Munkith Minat Dalal, very interesting, he talked about epistemological doubt, which actually predated René Descartes, the father of modern philosophy, in the 16th century. Al-Ghazali was talking about epistemological doubt in the 11th century, in the 12th century, 400 years before, where he said that knowledge begins with doubt. And he said that explicitly. I see, Al-Ghazali says, where a child was born as tabula rasa, was born as a white paper. Actually, John Locke used the word white paper. He didn't use the word tabula rasa, actually. As a white paper, it was his parents who colored him into a particular religion. And Al-Ghazali move on to say, I'm interested to know what is our original nature. I'm interested to find out what is the truth. I'm interested to find out what is the truth. In order to know the original truth, in order to know the original truth, I have to define what is knowledge. And in order to know the truth for certain, I have to define what is certain knowledge. In order to achieve certain knowledge, I have to doubt my knowledge. And he doubted everything. That our sense, he doubted our sensory perception. He even doubted mathematical truths, as 5 is more than 3. He even doubted that. Imagine that. And his ideas you can find in the works of René Descartes. You see, in the Muslim history, if you sort of move on to the next one. And even though I use the slides, I do not actually, to forget about how Ibn Yaqzon, they have... Okay, carry on. I just continue. In the Islamic history, actually, it is wrong to imagine that Islam and the West. We just talk about Islam and the West. As a result, we do not understand freedom. When other people talk about freedom, we say you're very liberal, Western. When people talk about liberty sounds like liberal. This is the thing, because we always think Islam and the West. We don't think of Islam in the West, or Westernization in Islamization itself. And if you go back to history, actually, we need to understand history to see what's going on in our, to make sense what's going on in our present situation, that in the medieval period, the West has to launch a crusade against the Muslim Empire, and the crusaders lost badly. Just like the ISIS nowadays, where they cannot defeat the West intellectually, they just slaughtered people, just like the crusaders. That's how they curb freedom. Crusaders, ISIS, in the name of religion. But they failed in the end. I'm sure ISIS will fail also one day. And what is the next step then? How does the West can battle against this rising Muslim empire, very strong? Militarily cannot. So they have to create a discourse. Now, to create a discourse, as Einstein say, I stand on the shoulders of giants. It's not just you create a discourse ex nihilo, out of nothing. We have to stand on giants. Who are the giants at the time? The intellectual giants at the time were the Muslim scholars, Al-Ghazali, Ibn Taymiyyah, what they called, Ibn Rushd, known as Averroes, Hayy Ibn Yaqzan, Ibn Tufayl, Ibn Sina, influenced Thomas Aquinas, which I don't have time to discuss, all their contributions, which has shaped secularism. So my thesis is that we must understand how the West used the Muslim ideas in order to create an entity called secularism. You see, when we are talking to ordinary masses, it's In Malaysia, we cannot simply tell people that, well, you have to be secular, you have to be liberal, inclusive, exclusive. People will not accept what we say. I'm worried about communicating with the masses. We have to sort of didict mereka, educate them so that they see the Western world as part of the process of Islamization. Part of the process of Islamization. And of course, this involves R&D, which is not easy. But let us begin with a very simple step. 5 more minutes of the Galileo controversy. Quickly. The Galileo controversy actually will inform us about what is freedom, actually, and how Maqasid Syariah deals with that. The Galileo controversy, Galileo actually a scientist who believed in heliocentrism, but the medieval church believed in geocentrism. Both theses goes against one another. One is by reason, Galileo, a scientist. Another one is by faith. So here, we have a problem of reason versus revelation. Here, when we are talking about human rights, the masses will look at it as human rights are using reason against revelation. Which one they will follow? Which one they will support in election? Will they support those who talk about reason, who privilege reason above revelation? Or they support the ulama, ketuanan ulama, who privilege revelation above reason? Can you see the problem? So when we talk about freedom based on the Maqasid Syariah, the first and foremost, we must deal with the issue, reason in relationship with revelation. Ibn Rushd talked about that in his Faslul Maqal, and Galileo talked about reminiscence to Ibn Rushd's idea of the relationship between reason and revelation. And I hope I have a chance to dwell into this idea of reason and revelation more in detail so that you can understand the idea of freedom according to Maqasid Syariah. For the simple reason that a robot, a computer, can we say that a computer truly has liberty? A computer brain, an artificial intelligence? We say no. Computer doesn't have liberty, doesn't have freedom. Next question I ask, why? Because they don't have reason. So, freedom, liberty, depends on how we position reason vis-a-vis revelation. As long as we do not deal with reason and revelation issue, we will not be able to deal with this problem. And I hope that I have a chance to talk about this more in our Q&A. Thank you very much.
I'm so sorry that I have to be cruel on time. But I'm going to be kind to our final discussion by 5 more minutes. Dr. Zulkifli Ahmad, Dr. Zhu, gained his doctorate from Imperial College in the medical science. But he decided to treat illness in politics. He was the former MP for Kuala Selangor in the 12th Parliament, previously executive director of PAS Research Centre. He's now the strategic director at Parti Amanah Negara. He writes extensively for local and international media on topics of economic development, socio-ethnic relations, the crash of civilization between Islam and the West, and politicizations of Islam. Now, we have had a very good and, I believe, eye-opening discussions on the meaning of Maqasid Syariah as well-being, its relations to justice and freedom. The reason why I'm going to give Dr. Zhu 5 more minutes than others is he was actually here right from the beginning, and he's tasked to respond more than this panel. Some of the things I would expect him to come up with, concrete answer. Now you know, nothing's come from free, Dr. Zhu. And it's also actually for those who were at the ICRAM convention last Sunday, you would know that this is actually a continuation. Dr. Zhu, in that convention, laid out, talk about second generations of Islamism, opposed Islamism. I think this is an important topic that we need to bring in into the context here. The very reason why we have this, why G25 came into being, was a response to Sharia law. Now, the obsession for specific form of Sharia law is very much tied back to Muslim nationalists' response to colonization. Now, how does Islamism, post-Islamism, respond to this? How do we move beyond this? How do Maqasid Syariah, because it's plural, how do Maqasid Syariah, you know, lift our country beyond this? Can this be a game changer for Malaysian politics? Now, those are the issues that expect Dr. Zhu to enlighten us. Dr. Zhu.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera to very distinguished audience, Tan Sri, Tan Sri, Datuk, and kawan, academics, and all. And my fellow, I'm not really a fellow panelist, I'm a discussant, supposedly. I have the privilege to have heard in some session the tail ends of it, but particularly this session that is ongoing. Honestly, I'm not quite sure where I'm coming from, but I think the Penang Institute and G25, Tansri, I think you have decided to invite me because I should be coming from the perspective of a political practitioner, of the political actor. Not so much of the academics. I don't pretend to be an academic now, although I used to be teaching. but coming from a perspective of political practitioner and actor, I would take liberty to, you know, wrap this up as I feel necessary and pertinent. John Locke, tabula rasa, state of fitra, and all the other jazz on what actually is coming to Maqasid, but not really Maqasid as such. It's a philosophical introduction to it. I thought Dr. Mazli would have make mention of John Stuart Mill, perhaps, or Jeremy Bentham on utilitarianism, the two sovereign of pleasure and pain. That would have alluded to something closer to what, you know, the elucidation of Maqasid, you know, by Imam Izzuddin Ibn Abdus Salam, which essentially is talking about he expounded on Al-Ghazali's the five imperatives, and then bringing the discussion further, moving ahead on the methodology of Qiyas, and then coming to be discussing it, you know, from the framework and this discipline of Maqasid, that would have come to a point of promoting al-maslaha, the public interest, the public interest, and essentially of wrapping it up into promoting what is known as promoting of benefit and prevention of harm. And that is essentially al-maqasid, of al-maslaha. I have simply got to move fast forward, assuming and presupposing that you might have gathered some understanding of Maqasid Syariah. Do you? From the first speaker right up to Sifu Nasir. And then I wouldn't want to, you know, 101 Maqasid Syariah kind of thing. But I would take it from the perspective of the historical narratives of what makes Maqasid right now to a person like me, you know, representing the second generation Islamic movement or political Islam that now believe that Maqasid Syariah is not just pertinent but mandatory perhaps to for Islamists to move ahead rather than being entrapped and stuck in that paradigm of the first generation Islamists or the Islamic political parties or the Islamic movement, where as a result of the onslaught of European colonial era or colonial rule rather, you know, how it has impacted on the psychology, the psychological, socio-cultural, religious, and the entire gamuts of life, how it has impacted the Muslim world then, and at the turn of the century, of course, and how the Muslim responses to this onslaught in finally bringing about a response that is essentially craft and premised on an anti-Western rhetorics and Western sentiment, how, you know, those era of onslaught has caused Muslim to respond it, the Muslim world responded to it in a manner that brought about this paradigm of characterized by anti-Western rhetoric, the Islamic State, yeah, and all the other characteristics that I say would represent the first generation Islamist movement or political Islam. Islamism in a nutshell I would quickly try to define it as the political project of bringing Islam into the domain of government and governance or into state power. That makes Islamists one who engages in the political project of making Islam, you know, the government of the day. So you've got Islamism defined, Islamists as opposed to just being a Muslim, and I've quickly make a mention of the first generation Islamist movement were essentially responding to the after effect or the impact of Western colonial rule. And it is quite understandable, arguably understandable, that that's how. And more importantly, Sharia, being the be-all and end-all of the solutions of the Muslim in their search for an identity and in the search for a legitimacy, founded on a struggle to reinstate the unity of the Ummah that has now, you know, been fragmentized by the colonial powers. So it is understandable why in the first generation of Islamists and Islamic movement or political Islam, the rhetoric was essentially anti-Western, primarily hatreds and enmity towards colonialism. Why it has got to be premised on establishing the political power of the Muslim and in uniting them in this rubric of Islamic State, and why it has got to be premised on Sharia, and essentially by that is meant the implementation of the Islamic Penal Code. The Muslim world witnessed that. And it took them a long time almost 500 years before not ulama, not the jurists, not the clergy, not the clerics, but intellectuals, university-based intellectuals, revisiting the work of Ash-Shatibi. The work of Ash-Shatibi in Muwafaqat. Ash-Shatibi, and suddenly you see a rise of a revival of all of the approach of Al-Maqasid. What is termed by Professor Ahmad Raishuni, a contemporary thinker, a Moroccan, in a term which he coined as al-sahwa al-maqasidiyya, the revival of the maqasid. Now let me just put that back together for you to be not lost. So the first generation was struggling against the after impact of colonial rule. And with that, of course, you have poverty, you have underdevelopment, you have unrepresentative authoritarian rule. Unfortunately, post-independence, the entire Middle Eastern state, Iraq, Syria, Egypt, they were all under despotic authoritarian rule. Given that political backdrop, what would you expect for a response from the Islamists and Islamic movement and Islamic political party? The rhetoric would have to be Al-Islam huwa al-hal. Islam is the solution, the be-all and end-all. And by that, it's meant reducing the offers to be essentially implement the Sharia, everything will be solved. That's what is also termed as legal reductionism, to reduce everything and solving the entire litany of problems, the plethora of problems of the Ummah, to getting Sharia implemented. That's it. We'll solve all of the Muslim problem. So the call for Islamic State is in that context. And the West, the anti-Western rhetoric as well, to be seen from that perspective. Now that is the first generation of Islamists and Islamic movement and Islamic political Islam. Now, come along with this. 500 years after the work of Ash-Shatibi, yeah, you get to see a response and writings and intellectual writings, you know, academic writings or a revisit of what was laid down by Ash-Shatibi in his Muwafaqat. Not attended to. Over 100 years. But suddenly, when the work of essentially, yeah, these later generations of intellectuals, in the name of, you know, perhaps Ibn Ashur, Ibn Ashur that who died in 1937. These are almost the contemporary, Islamist thinker. And of course, right now, you have, you know, among others, you have, of course, earlier would be Rashid Ridha, yeah. I mentioned about Ibn Ashur, Tahir Ibn Ashur, yeah. And of course, the most recent one you could recall of Tahar Jabir al-Iwani and al-Raishuni and of course al-Qardawi. Now these are the intellectuals, the Islamic intellectual, the Islamic contemporary thinkers, included of course Tariq Ramadan and others. Now their revisiting Maqasid, the Maqasid of Sharia, in the sense that Maqasid provide them, provided, you know, Maqasid provides a different perspective toward Islam. In the sense of, if the first generation were looking at Islam and Sharia to mean, and to only mean, the implementation of the Islamic Penal Code, unfortunately, grossly misrepresented, we see in the new narrative of Maqasid Sharia an opportunity. And truly enough, when the second generation Islamic movement and the second generation political Islam pick on Maqasid Sharia, suddenly it rearranges, it presents a different, you know, attitude and view towards Islam. That suddenly Islam is just not about punishing people. That suddenly Islam is just not about, you know, getting the penal. Oh my God. He gave me 5 extra injury time. So 5 times 5, eh? Rather than 5 plus 5. So, fellow friends, if I allow me to just, this is a very difficult subject that I'm now, you know, putting it all together. Now, what presents us, you know, what opportunity there are right now with Maqasid Asharia, meaning the higher intents, the higher objective of the Sharia, not the Sharia per se, but the higher intention, meaning the underlying reasons and wisdom of Sharia. That's become most important to be achieved, rather than, you know, the literal implementation of the verses, or particularly with respect to the penal code, has become, you know, an opportunity that provides Islamists to come forward to make a new, almost like a new political offers of Islam, the supreme purpose of Islam, and the supreme purpose of the political Islam is to establish justice for all. Premise on a verse, as for example, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu qumu kunu qawwamina lillahi shuhada'a bil qist wa la yajrimannakum shana'anu qawmin ala alla ta'adilu i'adilu huwa aqrabu littaqwa. Oh, you who believe, stand by Allah, witness, to be witness as a torch bearers of truth. Never do you allow yourself, wa la yajrimannakum shana'anu qawmin, your hatred and enmity towards anyone make you unable to establish justice. On the contrary, i'adilu, be just, huwa aqrabu littaqwa, for that is nearer to piety and righteousness. Now, with that message of justice being the supreme purpose of Sharia, and the 5 imperatives that is laid down by al-muwafaqat, by Ash-Shatibi, and expounded and elucidated further by the contemporary Islamist thinker like Ibn Ashur, adding on 2 more of the imperative to be not Dariyatul Khamsah, but Dariyatul Sab'ah. Not the 5 of Hibzul Aqal, Hibzul Deen, Hibzul Aqal, Hibzul Nafs, Hibzul Nasab, and Hibzul Mal. Not the just simply the preservation of Deen or religion. And by religion, it's just not Islam. It's all religion. Take that as a note. Because there's a verse in the Quran, وَلَوْ لَا دَفُوا اللَّهِ النَّاسِ بَعْضُهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَفَسَدَتِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَوْ لَا دَفُوا اللَّهِ النَّاسِ بَعْضُهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَهُدِّمَتْ سَوَمِعٌ وَبِيَعٌ وَسَلَوَاتٌ وَمَسَاجِدٌ يُذْكَرُ فِيهَا اسْمُ اللَّهِ. Allah makes it very clear, had the check and balance, had not Allah willed the check and balance between human being, one group by another, the entire places of worship, of monastery, of churches, of masajid, will all be destroyed. Meaning, in the Maqasid, in the objective, in the high objective of Islam and Sharia, not just preservation, but the sanctity, the sacred sanctity of all these religious places of worship must be secured. Now, with that, adding on to the 5, Ibn Ashur added on Hafzul Hurriya. Sifu Nasir was attempting to only allude to it philosophically, though. Hafzul Hurriya, preservation of freedom. And finally, Hafzul Adala, preservation. Now, with us as second generation political Islam and Islamic movement, we no longer talk about preservation. We must move forward with just not preservation, but enrichment and enhancement. And I would, given time, elaborate to you what is meant by each and every one of them, especially on the last two, enhancement and preservation of freedom and justice. These provide us this opportunity, especially on Amana. Suddenly we feel that, you know, we felt that this is a truly blue ocean strategy. We just want to cut off from our immediate past, the past that is now past, and offers you an opportunity to represent Sharia, not in the legal reductionist sense, not in the exclusive sense. It is presented and encapsulated, or it is frame and premise on establishing justice for all in a very inclusive manner. And it's essentially based on the imperative of Sharia in securing the seven necessities of life. As-sab'a ad-daruriyya. And that is the essence of Sharia. And that is how Sharia must be communicated to the entire segment of citizenry and the entire electorate and voters. Because that would what change the perception of Sharia be essentially prohibitive and punitive. I tell you, this is an opportunity for Parti Amanah Negara. When Erdogan, Tayyip Erdogan, broke away from Professor Nikmatin Arbakan from his Saadat and Arifah party, Erdogan and Abdullah Gul and his perhaps G18, their version of the G18, yeah, they lost the election and they move out. And they were a lot lesser than us. We move out with G18. They were only about G10. When they were very single-mindedly forging a new political engagement of political Islam, not even wanting to be called themselves Islamist party, but everything was an embodiment of the imperatives of Sharia. And they know exactly what need to be done first. They are all important, but they know the demand of al-fiqh al-awlawiyyat, the fiqh, the discipline of prioritization. You're not willing to talk even about anything Sharia in that narrow sense of a penal code and number of things I could elaborate to you. But they were sure of what need doing first, of how to secure the trust and the confidence, and what need solving first. They know exactly the demands of al-fiqh of al-awlawiyyat, that is essentially a taqdim, ahammu min al-muhim, to put forward what is more important than all the very important things. They are all important, yes, but what is more important for us to get solved and then put in perspective a meaning of a vibrant and functional government and governance in the sense of a democracy. The rule of law. Where the rule of law, as-siyada al-qanuniyya, is upheld. Now that is the narrative of the new second generation Islamist movement or Islamist political party. And that's how we want to relate ourselves. And that's how we want to be a critical political player. We want to be in this contestation where, through our inclusive manner, inclusive approach, would want to be part of nation rebuilding, and perhaps human civilization remaking. In the offers of Islam and the maqasid of Islam, the higher intents and objective of Islam, the entire intent of the objective of the Sharia, which are also universal, timeless principles and values. Now that is our offer. That is the offer of the new Islamist political Islam that is not quite liked by some, understandably so, because the way you are not willing to implement Sharia. I said, what? Yeah, you don't implement the hudud. I said, is that the be all and all of Sharia? If you understand democracy, you would know that whatever the policy of what have you, you would subject it to the legislative and democratic process. There must be things that have got to be solved first. You've got to put in place. You've got to put in place the rule of law. For without a viable, free and fair election as the cardinal cornerstone of a vibrant democracy, you can shout your throat out, whatever. You'll never get done. So we know exactly how we want to move and why we move. And the essence of a coalition politics is so pertinent to a mixed demography like ours. And the way our former party is moving more towards the right was exactly the fear that we have once upon a time. This country, if it's going towards a Malay Muslim supremacist, will drag us all down on the dark alley of self-destruction. And the way it's going, the rhetoric, the racism, the red shirt, supported by some senior ministers on ground zero on that day, is despicable to say of the least. Fellow friends, given the time constraint, and whatever that I prepared is so irrelevant now, these guys overdose of philosophy, which is actually pertinent. You know, but that's how, coming from first principles, you derive all this, you know, that's how it should be. But I'm not quite sure whether this is the right platform. Perhaps it is the best platform. So, because, you know, if it's said to, in any other places, I have my doubts. But looking at your distinguished audience here, those are just 101. You can take more of that. But what I've given to you is a sharing coming from the perspective of a political actor wishing to be a critical player in nation rebuilding. And I hope that has made some sense over why Maqasid. Actually, we have not dealt with Maqasid in any great depth, actually. It's just an introduction and, you know, said in many tangential way, obliquely, indirectly. But I think a good lecture on just Maqasid would be excellent for you to really get in grasp. But I've said about the five imperatives and now seven imperatives and how this will affect the dynamics that we want to forge in the political contestation in our beloved country that's now almost failing, if not a failed state as yet. I thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Zhu. So sorry to cut this short. Well, you all know that all our speakers, 10 panelists and discussant today, each of them know enough to deliver a whole hour lecture. So we are not doing justice to their knowledge, but I think this is an important time for us to explore. And so I apologize for cutting you all short. Now, we have about half an hour. We have about half an hour for Q&A. I would like to have two rounds of question and answers so that we invite three questions each round and then we go back to the speakers. The second round, then we wrap up. Then we move on. Before I pass the mic to the floor, I have one question that I feel compelled to carry it from the first panel. I think it was a very important question that put forward by Mr. Aston. The question is really core to our discussion on Sharia. Today, when we talk about Sharia law, this is like, you know, the Sharia that you mentioned, that going beyond the legalistic, positivist, reductionist framework is not what we understand by most people. What people read today as Sharia is what we have in the law. Mr. Aston Paiwa proposed in the morning and say that maybe, you know, this should be called rightly as in the past Islamic administrative law. So then, because Sharia can have a wider meaning. Because otherwise, whatever you talk about, laws that have been made by Jakim and all the states would be seen as like you're attacking, you're criticizing Allah. I think in that sense, many people would not feel comfortable to have any opinion, right? So that's my first question. I would now open the floor.
Thank you. I have a few, couple of questions. I think Dr. Zul, you know, had begun to address the issues, the concrete issues surrounding Maqasid Syariah. But I'd like to suggest that the panelists, I feel that, you know, the discussion was maybe a bit too general, and it could result in, you know, people feeling that the central issues are being avoided. See, the point is this. We all agree, you know, about Maqasid Sharia, as it is about transparency, it's about good governance, etc., etc. And there's a lot of literature about that. We are familiar with that. And we also agree that Sharia has a broader meaning. I think you all are students of jurisprudence or Islamic thought in general. In earlier times, Sharia refers to a way of life. Even the term fiqh did not mean jurisprudence. You know, it was something more general. A faqih was somebody more than, you know, an expert in jurisprudence. These things we know. But even if we accept that, it avoids the question of what is Sharia in the narrow sense, hudud laws, because it is also that, right? The majority of jurists agree that cutting of the hands should be implemented. A stunningly large number of jurists agree that the death penalty for apostasy is death. We need to deal with those issues, because even if we say we are going to have Sharia based on the idea of Maqasid Sharia, we're going to have transparency, are you saying therefore there'll be no death penalty or no stoning to death? That's out, right? Are we saying that Shiites and Bohras and other minorities are allowed to practice openly? We need to deal with those issues concretely. And I think when you talk about implementing Sharia, even if it's in the context of Maqasid Sharia, people want to know how does it translate concretely? Then you can get the support you need. That's one point. I'd like all of you to respond to that. I just want to mention about Ibn Taymiyyah, because he's often misunderstood. Ibn Taymiyyah was, I think his scholarship on hadith and on fiqh is acceptable to the Sunnis, but where he is rejected, and it's not because of a misunderstanding, where he's rejected is because of aqidah, the issue of his creed. The majority of Sunni scholars rejected him for his creed, issues concerning tajsim on alleged anthropomorphism of Ibn Taymiyyah and other issues relating to theology. But where, you know, other issues are concerned, that's another matter. Salafis do derive some of their positions on various issues from Ibn Taymiyyah. But even in their case, they have also misunderstood him. While Ibn Taymiyyah, for example, was very much against Shiites, he never advocated a position whereby Shiites would be forbidden to exist and to practice. So our Salafis, and I would say also Sunni extremists, have failed to live up to the ideas of Ibn Taymiyyah. Can I also with reference to the term kafir, I'm very reluctant to use the term. I take the view that some religious scholars take, that kafir does not refer to a non-Muslim. does not simply refer to a non-Muslim. It is not synonymous with a non-believer. Rather, it refers to those who intentionally cover up the truth. And that's based on the idea that the term kafir, derived from kafara, means to cover up the truth. So there are many non-Muslims who are not kafir, and there are some some ulama who say that it is in fact not allowed to use the term kafir to refer to Jews and Christians in particular. So I think we should be very circumspect in the way we use the term. My final comment, Dr. Zulkifli, the idea Islam huwa wal hal, and you were explaining why the reductionist approach towards Islam and the anti Western civilization attitude, you're explaining it in terms of the the colonial period, which is true. But I just wanted to point out one thing. It was not the only response of Muslims in the colonial period. And you know, sometimes we neglect our neighbor. For example, Syarikat Islam in Indonesia, and even later on, some decades later, the Masyumi. They were responding and critiquing colonialism, but they did not follow the style of thought of the Middle Easterners. So Chokro Minoto, for example, strong critique of colonialism, but didn't go the way of Islam huwa al hal. So maybe we also have to be more familiar with. I'm not referring to you. I'm saying in general, we tend to imitate or blindly imitate what is happening in the Middle East, and we ignore the serious intellectual legacy of Nusantara. Yes.
Thank you very much. Dr. Zul, I cannot comment on the philosophical arguments because I'm not trained in that. You said you hope that everything you said is relevant to this forum. I would say that everything that you say is relevant. Because just look at what happened in the Arab Spring countries. When they overthrew the Mubarak regime, and in Tunisia, they overthrew the president. They didn't ask for more Sharia, or they didn't ask for more religion. They asked for democracy. They asked for jobs. They want their children to be employed, and they want to escape from poverty. And I think that is what is Maqasid is all about. The first principle of Maqasid is the well-being of the Ummah and justice for the Ummah. And I would say that economic justice is the first principle of Maqasid. I don't know whether you agree with me about that. Thank you very much.
We'll come back for the second round. Yeah, Rashida Shuib from USM. I would like to pose this question to Dr. Zul, my friend. Lama tak jumpa. I am glad for after so many years, the women's groups have been fighting for this justice for all framework. I heard this not today. I heard this in 1994, 1993, when already we were talking about, can we not look at, for example, Muslim family law within this framework of justice, which is fundamental, we believe, in Islam. Yet, and it is preservation of freedom. Yet, I am also very skeptical. I mean, we are talking about really brewing new coffee in the same pot. Can you really do this if you do not deconstruct the society that we have in our country, which is very, very patriarchal? And do not tell me that patriarchy comes from the West. Patriarchy may be the word from the West, but the experience of patriarchy, I deal with grassroots women, with women who have been violated by their husbands, who do not get the nafqa, etc., etc. So patriarchy is not about the West. Patriarchy is here with us. We live it, breathe it. So if this is the cup that we have, you can talk about Maqasid Syariah in what? In the same cup? Or do you want to deconstruct that cup?
Now, I'm sorry. Okay, in short of time, I would like to invite, sir, yes, you.
and then Madam at the back, and Dr. Nawab. Okay. So we go one round. This is the last round, and then our speaker would have a chance to respond. Yes, please.
Okay, thank you. So my name is Ahmad Taqiuddin. So I would like to respond just by saying I believe Maqasid Syariah is potentially a game changer. Okay, but Maqasid Syariah is also about being contextual, about we applying the real, the true and the essence of Syariah according to different places in our localities. Okay, but how long do you think that this way of new idea will it take for us to actually reform the politics, reform the government, reform the society and all the systems that we are currently in, considering the level of intellect and tolerance that we are currently in, which I can say quite disappointing. So will this Maqasid Syariah ever succeed in our local scene? And if it if this will ever succeed, how long do you think will it take? Okay, so that is my question. Thank you.
Yeah, assalamualaikum. First, I have two things. First, to share what the government of Selangor is doing. This is a result from the royal speech by Tuanku Sultan, who has adopted the Maqasid Syariah to be utilized as a policy in the administration of the Selangor government. And I believe they have a unit within the government that will do the R&D in the respect of Maqasid Syariah. Maybe all parties or stakeholders concerned about Maqasid Syariah could, you know, come together and come up with something really concrete for the well-being of the Malaysian people. Secondly, you know, we can talk about Maqasid Syariah, keadilan, the justice and everything else, but we need to know whether it is, you know, really done or is successful. That comes to the idea of measuring it, you know. Well, in the contemporary arena, in any activism these days, you do have indices to measure successes of anything or any policy or any aspirations, you know, for the well-being of the people, the Human Development Index. And of course, I'm a woman, they have the Gender Gap Index. Although we may, you want to call it Maqasidi indices, we may have some kind of mechanism or further inclusivity of what those indices will be. You know, in Islam, they always use women to measure, you know, like safety and security, for instance. There is a hadith that says there should be safety and security, you know, when a woman that travels from her home so far away to Sana'a in Yemen and return to her home safe and sound. So women are always used during the Prophet's time as measure of the successes of the Islamic objectives or the Maqasid Syariah's objective. I think we hope that this aspiration is not merely in words, but there must be some measure of its success. Thank you.
Sorry, just to quickly comment, I think there is a study that was done called the Islamicity Index, in which the Muslim countries actually all fared very, very poorly. The most Islamic country was Ireland, just to, you know, highlight. My question is to Dr. Zul, and it's kind of similar to what you had the brother earlier had to ask, which is the realities of the religio-political realities of Malaysia. I mean, you highlighted the example of Turkey with the AKP and the Rafah, but you know they've had this whole history of this Anatolian Islam, which was very much entrenched. I mean, when you look at what Ehsan Yilmaz or Hakan Yabuz have talked about, this is a very important factor. My own, I mean, as a political scientist, you know, I've looked at various elections in Malaysia. In fact, I would even argue that, you know, I think the ground might actually work against your sort of agenda, especially in the places where the votes would actually matter, which is now going to be in the northern states of Malaysia. This is, or the rural areas of Malaysia where the real fight will be between you and you know, your previous your alma mater, if you like, whatever. so how would you deal with this? And I think it's gonna take years. I mean, today when you talk to the Muslim masses, forget Malaysia, even you go to Indonesia or Malaysia, or in Singapore, the understanding of Sharia is very limited, you know, and how are you going to translate that politically and translate that into votes? So that's my question to Dr. Zhu.
Yeah, I go first. Most junior. Okay, now, as a philosopher, I look at the problems that you highlighted, whether it's a problem of democracy, problem of terrorism, problem of what happening in Syria, in Egypt, what happening in Malaysia, extremism and so on, all boils back to one problem, the use of reason. No democracy will be successful if the people do not know how to use their reason in an efficient way. And it goes back, and I'm a teacher, it goes back to educational system. To what extent we train our students, our children, to use their reason. And in Islam, we have the problem of al-aql wa naql, you see. And you talk about Maqasid. Maqasid Syariah is a manual. Fiqh awlawiyat, the fiqh of prayer, are manuals. You cannot use this manual if the society do not know how to use reason or put reason in its proper place. And this is the problem that we see. People coming out from Sekolah Agama, Pondok, you see, what is Islam? Islam is free pork zone. Tak makan babi, you're already a Muslim. This is the problem. And I'm handling with revert cases also. People bin Abdullah for many years. People who become Muslim, bin Abdullah, what for? Your father is not Abdullah. But if you argue with them, they'll say, don't argue. Don't ask why. Because Islam, you must put revelation al-naql above al-aql. This is the problem. And you ask them what's the meaning of revelation, they say Quran and Sunnah. But you ask more, they don't know how to answer. This is the problem. Because in order to understand the Quran, we have to again use reason. In order to understand hadith, you have to use reason. So if they refuse to put reason in its proper place, no matter what you say, democracy, inclusive, exclusive, they don't listen to you. And this is the problem that I see when I'm teaching future ustadz, ustaza, my students, many of them are future ustadz and ustaza, new generation. I see this problem it's a never-ending problem. They don't want to use reason. That is the problem. And so we have to deal with this issue, reason and revelation, in our educational system. Tell them how to use their reason. Of course, it's a very basic issue, but it's not easy. Because when we use reason, we say, that is Western. That is liberal. That is the problem. Imagine that we are fighting for democracy, but the people do not want to reason. What kind of democracy are we going to fight for? The democracy will become like French Revolution. Remember French Revolution? Even though they fought for equality, liberty. What is another one? A fraternity, what happened? It became a totalitarian state. That is the thing. I'm afraid that democracy itself will become totalitarian. Okay, so I would say that go back to the basic. Al-aql wa naql, deal with this relationship. And I don't have the time to talk, as Dr. Wong was saying, that we are used to talk for at least 1 hour. There's a time constraint. And I would just have to give a formula, is that we see how the West, don't think of the West as outside Islam, other than Islam. No, think of how the West use Islamic ideas in their context and build a civilization. Look at it. And I cannot just talk in just 20 minutes. It's impossible. Give some time for us to explain that, you see. Yeah, I cannot. So I'll come back if I have a chance.
Okay. Yeah, there are a lot of things to answer, but I mean, talking about deconstructing the patriarch mentality, whatever. I mean, I'm just wondering, due to a lot of issues, coming back to Sifu's argument, the idea of reason, I think in some of the cases, because I don't come from elite background, I'm only a marhain like other people from under class society. We grew up and a lot of students that we're dealing with, I think in most of the cases of domestic abuses, it's all about educational level. Okay. And in many cases, I mean, based on a PhD thesis done by one of my students in Durham University, she interestingly, she found out that major cases that led towards domestic violence because of drinking and gambling. And another thing is, yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure. Maybe we can challenge her thesis. But, you know, just believing in certain meta-narrative and then you force people to believe. I mean, we have to open door for discussion and argument. But anyway, I mean, you're free to believe in whatever you believe in. But let's not forget about husband abuse too. A lot of husbands being abused of late, and I dealt with that problem a lot. Okay, but anyway, coming back to Ibn Taymiyyah, it's very interesting talking about Ibn Taymiyyah. I know where I come from. I think you have listened to Micho the other day. You were with Yahya Micho in Nottingham, and I think Micho is the person who was an expert about Ibn Taymiyyah, especially on the relation between jihad and Ibn Taymiyyah's idea. But let's not forget Fazlur Rahman. But one, yeah, I couldn't disagree with you that certain school of thoughts, especially the mainstream Ash'ari school of thoughts, have a lot of problem with Ibn Taymiyyah when it comes to details of the creed, not the major. Because when there's a difference between the core principles, idea of creed, and the elementary, and it's very furrow. And if you want to blame Ibn Taymiyyah of certain of his belief, we have to blame also Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, where he took all those ideas from. But anyway, one thing that we should appreciate Ibn Taymiyyah in the way he deal with Shia, he did not deal with them with power, because, I mean, the government of during his day victimized him a lot, so he has no power in dealing with Shia. But he dealt with them intellectually. He came out with the book Minhaj al-Sunnah in his refutation of Al-Hilli's book. This is what we are lacking of nowadays. I mean, we don't have any intellectual discourse when dealing with differences. I think that is what we're having nowadays. We have a lot of fringe. You mentioned about Ahmadiyya, you talk about Shia, and talking about Shia, even Shia themselves did not allow the Shia fringe to challenge the mainstream. For example, people like Saroj, people like Ahmad Al-Khatib, people like, let me say, the one from Lebanon, Muhammad Hassan Fadlullah, they were not given opportunity to challenge the Iranian Safavid mainstream idea of Shia. And even, I mean, I believe some of the audience here may subscribe to the mainstream Iranian Safavid Shia. You should also try to listen to all those fringes. Okay, the problem here, we don't really appreciate reason, like Sifu said. To acknowledge, I mean, I could understand, I may not agree with the idea of our religious administration when they're dealing with those different school of thoughts, but I could understand their worry. Their worry is, if you allow certain groups to be at the center, it will undermine the center itself. For example, you allow Shia to be at the center, the basic creed of the Shia, the basic creed of Imamiyah, at least the mainstream Safavid Imamiyah, is believing and is excommunicating many, if not excommunicating clearly, but, you know, what we say? Menyesatkan certain of big pillars of the companions. You know, by agreeing with that, it's a very zero-sum game. But again, when they're using force, yeah, we can talk about that later. that what they believe in. No, I mean, that what Jabatan Agama believe in. No, I try to understand how they think. Okay, I'm talking about the mainstream Jabatan Agama, the way they deal with the Shia, because of that zero-sum game. I know what you mean. I know what you mean, because I've met a lot of friends. Even my Adi Angkat was an Ayatollah, still an Ayatollah. We could agree a lot of matters. We could disagree. And I think he could find a lot of agreements with me rather than the mainstream Imamiyah. I mean, if you look people like Ahmad Al-Khatib, Kasharosh, who doesn't believe in Ismatul Imam, in the infallibility of Imam, that's very against the mainstream. But they're not allowed to voice that even in Iran. Be more in Najaf or Karbala. So when talking about this kind of discrimination or whatever, it does not only exist in dominated Sunni country, but also in Iran. In Iraq, now it became another Shia country. So, but talking about Ibn Taymiyyah, he managed to deal with them intellectually. This is what we lost in our religious discourse. Religious discourse in Malaysia is all about power. I mean, we are the mainstream. We are okay. We're going to punish you because you don't subscribe to the mainstream. Okay, I disagree with that. I mean, but I could understand why they are acting like that. But that does not mean I condone whatever they are doing. Yeah. So I hope you are clear. Okay. So coming back to Dr. Ching Huat's argument about the Sharia law, should it be called Sharia law? I mean, the only place that people call Muslim family law as Sharia is only Malaysia. You go to other places, they don't call it Sharia law. They call it Ahwa Shakhsiyah. They call it family law. Family law. No, they do have civil for the non-Muslims, yeah. But the Islamic family law is for Muslims. But unfortunately, in Malaysia, we call it Sharia. Okay. Even we don't call the courts as mahkamah as courts for Muslim family law. We call it mahkamah Sharia. And I think the only university that called Sharia law department is our Ahmad Ibrahim School of Law. We call it Sharia law department. It's one small department. But anyway, you call it Sharia law. Actually, it's very misleading. It should be called Muslim family law department or whatever. So this confusion has led towards a lot of other confusions. Yeah. And, okay, talking about the Muslim Sharia, I'm not in that situation to talk about that. But I think a lot of shortcomings in the administration of those so-called Sharia courts has led towards these family issues and women discrimination and whatnot. Thank you very much.
Right. Okay, fine. I will. In fact, I thank my colleague to have, get them to answer a lot of the questions that have been raised earlier. Now I'm left with only Tansri's question, and I would only comment over the last point on the issue of Dr. Farid.
Also, Dr. Nawab.
Dr. Nawab as well. Okay, quickly, Tansri, you are right. I was watching and listening to Right Honourable Prime Minister's Minister of Finance budget. And in the course of his delivering it, I tweeted almost 14 times. And one of it is when quite close to the end, he make a mention of invoking Maqasid Syariah. Did you remember that? And quickly I said, Prime Minister, please just do not pay lip service to Maqasid Syariah. The essence of Maqasid Sharia, in the sense of Hifzul Mal, the preservation of property, and hinges among other things. You know, if I quickly, I'm quite conscious of the time, don't worry. The overriding principle of Islamic economy is of the wealth creation, is wealth distribution or redistribution. And the principles of distributive justice is so cardinal in this Islamic economy. And there's a verse in the Quran that will really pinpoint to the maqasid of it. Where Allah says in Surah Al-Hashr, كَيْلَ يَكُولَ دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ مِنْكُمْ, that let not the wealth be circulating or only circulates among the rich and the super rich of you. Agniya iminkum. Now, that points to a very important principle of distributive justice in Islam. And until and unless you address the issue of inequality by your both income and wealth, you know, you, and of course, looking at the endemic problem of leakages and embezzlement of late, nowhere any semblance of an economy that represent the maqasid of Sharia. Now, and if we are to get to administering this nation, the issue of ensuring the problem of inequality, of a disparity, you know, and we have what on the worst. You know, both inter and intra-ethnic, that would not warrant any to simply, you know, make mention of Maqasid Syariah. We have fulfilled Maqasid Syariah. Kita telah menepati tuntutan Maqasid Syariah while, you know, the very, you know, unending malaise, penyakit, yeah, of the economy is essentially about how you have mismanaged the resources and wealth of the nation. And that is very critical in the verse of the Quran, huwa anshahum min al-ard wa sta'amarakum fiha. And the final maqasid of economy is to prosper the nation with prospering the citizenry, the rakyat. Yeah, mensejahterakan dan memakmurkan negara dan rakyat. That is maqasid. Do we get anywhere near that? When you see, you know, all that I've said earlier about the... Okay, sorry, Dr. Wong Chin. Let me just quickly answer. Dr. Nawab, thank for reminding us. You know, surely we need not need that kind of reminder, being politicians. But at the end of the day, you know, we have got vote to count. True, we have our idealism, we have our moral compass, we have our strategic consideration, whatnot. But at the end of the day, you know, we are going to be both politically savvy, yet, you know, we are principle centered. Now, Amanah being only about a few months old, you know, given the 2 years down the road before the next GE, the 14 GE, would really have to, you know, strategize and go back to the drawing board. Honestly, I'll tell you, we have run numbers. We have run numbers with this baseline of 213 GE, and we know exactly what will happen in the event of a three-corner fight, of a two-corner fight and whatnot. Now, if I could just, you know, recap this, the reason why, among other things, why Amanah find its inception was premised on the fact that the day we were ousted, the day we were no longer with our old party, that was also the day when the coalition politic of Pakatan Rakyat is dismantled. And to us, this tahaluf al-siyasi, muakfakat politik dan coalition politic, is so pertinent, as I said earlier. I alluded to it earlier, and this finds its deliberation and premise on on the tradition of the Prophet, on helpful fudul, and this is going to be a discourse if I go to elaborate on that. But essentially what we are saying is, yes, you know, it will take a longer time for us to get Maqasid across. But mind you, we have secured what we were out to do, in the sense of ensuring that the non-Muslim, non-Malay votes would not, you know, erode from the support of Islam and the Islamist Party. We fear that, you know, the minute they felt betrayed by whatever, you know, so by all those inconsistencies and whatnot. So one of our reason that to say, you know, reason for being and for existing is to ensure that this support from our non, I wouldn't want to use the word non-Malay, non-Muslim, you know, prefer to them, call them Chinese, Indian, and various adherents of other religious commitment and conviction. We want to ensure that would be secured. Over and above that, we can address the Malay constituencies. And Malay is not a monolithic ethnic group. You've got to segmentize them, rural, suburban, yeah, and as well, you know, the more discerning, and the one that is always entrapped in this politic of fear and politic of poverty of the ruling regime. It will take a long time, and that's need a lot of using reasons and knuckle and unuckle. You know, that we've got a very big challenge at hand. But nonetheless, we have got to put it right. We cannot do it wrong. Just because we got to get a Malay vote, are we going to move the right and further right and call on now the supremacies of the Malay Muslim doctrines? Will we go that way? Surely not. We will stand to be the true torchbearers of justice and present Islam in the most inclusive way. And this is not about being expedient or vote getting. This is about first, you know, abiding to the real universal imperative values of Islam. And of course we've got to be savvy. Of course we've got to, you know, the way we would have to approach the various segments of Malay, we have got to go back to the drawing board. I thank you for your reminders. I think that was the last one. I thank you. And I thank you, Penang Institute and G25, Tan Sri, for this opportunity. It has been, you know, it's a great pleasure addressing a very distinguished audience and crowd who are always, you know, discerning. If I could, if I finish by quoting Edmund Burke, evil will thrive when good men and good women sit at home doing nothing. But because you are here, we believe that you will be the force of change and the game changer with all of us. I thank you.
Dr. Iqbal?
Okay. All right. So I would like to invite you to give a round of big hand to our panelists and discussants who bring us to deal with, to address the concern in Malaysia, but also to see the connection between Islam and the West, which many of us are blinded from by, you know, the past manifestations of the first generation Islamism, if you may. Right. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Masli, Dr. Iqbal, Mr. Abdul Nasir, Dr. Zulkifli, and Dr. Wong for the enlightening discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, we are nearing the end of today's forum. And finally, let us all please welcome Datuk Dr. Sharam Ahmad onto the stage to give his closing remarks.
Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you all. I think at this stage of the afternoon, the last thing you want to hear is another presentation. When I was teaching at the university, I was always reminded that the attention span of students is 20 minutes. And when the hour is 50 minutes, you have to break it up into three. I just want to say on behalf of G25, on behalf of my colleagues and mentors in the G25, how grateful we are to Penang Institute, to the Penang State Government, the Chief Minister in particular, and also to our good friend and fellow member, Dato Sri Nazir Arif, through whom his company has been very generous to ensure that this forum is a success. On behalf of G25 also, I must thank our 9 panelists, Dato Zul as the discussant, our 3 moderators, for, I think, an extremely meaningful intellectual day. I want to say also in closing that the G25 is a group of individuals. We are not an NGO or an organization, but just a group of concerned and worried citizens, whose aim is really to see Malaysia being a moderate, progressive, just, and compassionate nation. And our first focus, as Tan Sri Sharif had explained this morning, was really to focus on the administration of Islam, and to try and see whether we can bring about changes and reforms in order to strengthen the institutions that govern religion. We are also concerned that standards of governance and administration are somewhat lacking, to put it mildly. And we are concerned also that religious authorities sometimes seem to forget the importance of social justice, and in particular, the rights of women and the welfare of children. These are things that these are things that we think must be addressed urgently. There is obviously in this troubled and challenging times an air of depression. But as YB Zaril says, even in the Middle East, despite all their problems, there seems to be a sense of hope, and we must hold on to that sense of hope in Malaysia. If this can be achieved, then we will be able to portray Islam as a religion of moderation, a religion of compassion, to which both Muslim and non-Muslims are able to subscribe to. And these are values, attributes, which are consistent with the federal constitution, consistent with Rukun Negara, and certainly enjoined in the Holy Quran, universal in nature. And and so what we hope is not just changes and reforms in governance and administration of religious institutions, but institutions as a whole, and that good governance is something that we hope for. And in this context, I think what we have heard from the 3 sessions, many of what G25 is trying to do are being reaffirmed. But at the same time, it's quite clear that there are shortcomings on our part, and the discussion in the second panel, for example, has reminded me at least we need to look at the shortfalls at the moment, and I certainly now have a slightly better understanding of Maqasid and Maqasid Syariah, but there's a lot more that I think we need to do. The G25 has a strategy paper, and I think in the light of what has transpired today, we need perhaps to look at it again, Tan Sri and Dato Latifah, and refine and improve our strategy paper. Lastly, G25 cannot do this by ourselves. We have to have partners. And I hope that many of you who represent other organizations and bodies, especially the women, I hope will join and help us to make the ultimate objective of a moderate, progressive, just and compassionate nation a reality. So thank you very much to all of you for coming and contributing so fruitfully. I have been asked before I step down to do a little bit of marketing. This is the Aman message, which Malaysia under Pak Lah when he was Prime Minister and his son-in-law signed on behalf of Malaysia, but everybody seems to have forgotten about the Aman message. So this is available at the back, with a donation of 10 ringgit, which I'm told will go to G25. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sharam Ahmad, for your enlightening closing remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, we have now come to an end of today's event. Thank you so much for coming today, and we hope that you have gained much insight about Maqasid Syariah, its principles, and its standing in the constitutional democracy in our forum today. There is actually coffee and tea at the Oriental Spoon, which is just down the hall, so please enjoy some nibbles and coffee and tea before you leave. We truly appreciate your participation and your support, and we hope to see you at our next event. Thank you, everyone.